I'm Jeff Bradshaw with Redneck Restorations. This old truck brought to you by ElderlyIron.com. Now, for those of you who don't know, the 1955-9 Chevrolet and GMC trucks had heaters in them that could be best described as anemic. So we're going to take care of that problem in crusty old granddad here by installing this Weber diesel-fired heater. You didn't really think I was going to do that, did you? So before we get into this thing, I'm going to tell you, you look down in the description below, you'll see if you want to bump all the way to the end to see my final summarization on this thing, feel free to do it. But if you want to see what goes on with this thing from beginning to end, and possibly how you can operate this thing and not make the mistakes I did, watch on.
I was not going to do an unboxing video because there are several of them on YouTube already, but perhaps, maybe I should have. Because this is the way it came out of the box. I mean, no big deal, but it's you expect that it's going to be round when you get it, right? Well, I managed to get the clamp down past the other clamp using the access knot in the side. I still don't like this. Gotta make a shield. They call this an air filter. This is not an air filter. There's nothing in there. Oh, why? Look at that. Pinholes. Alright, that's gotta get taken care of. I'd say a little something was lost in the... In fact, I have a better idea. I'm always full of better ideas. A little bit of fiberfill. You know that stuff you make pillows with? That'll do, pig. Mo better. Alright, so here's an interesting phenomenon. Dee 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 dee. Phenomenon. Dee 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 dee. It's giving an arc. A little spark. So there's a significant current draw there. It's not turned on yet. So there's something to know. It's going to draw current not being on. Now, when I was approached by this company, they offered me, well, not this unit because this unit has four ports, but it had the readout display like that, which I didn't want. You know, I had no interest. I saw these all over YouTube. Hey, I'd really like to have one of these. Because my greenhouse, I think this would work great in my greenhouse. But it's a 12-volt power supply, which means you got to have a 12-volt power supply. But the more I saw, the more interested I became. And so when they approached me, I said, yeah, we'll see what they're like. This was out of stock. Here's what you get to choose from. So I chose this one because they let me. Because it just has the knob and the button. Now, when you grew up in the 60s and 70s, microwave ovens, they used to just turn a knob to the time that you wanted and push the button and it would go ding and your food's hot. Not anymore. No, you have to program something for it to work. So when I saw this, I thought, oh, turn the knob, push the button. What could be better? Well, it's not quite that way because they also give you a remote. And I find out this doesn't turn at all. So there's no knob here and it's held on with the double stick tape. Nicely installed there. So they give you the instructions in the manual of how to connect. Now the people who translate these manuals don't have the greatest grip on the English language. If you go to the beginning, all right, the caveat. Number four, after the red power line is connected, you need to check whether the load voltage reaches 1.5 volts and there is no need to check the battery or wiring. Bidirectional remote control receiving. Remote control pairing. Press the on-off button 5 times continuously and quickly. The indicator light flashing means it has entered the remote control pairing waiting state. At the same time, press the power button plus setting button on the remote control for a long time to start the remote control pairing. Wait for the auto completion of pairing to exit. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, it did something. Power up the remote. Pairing, please wait. Meanwhile, ow, ow! The cat claws into your leg. Did it pair? I didn't see this come on. Oh, well, I didn't see it come on, but it's off now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so what I did was I pressed and held that button for about 2 seconds, and then the unit came on. But who knows what it will do. I mean, the fan's running. There's air coming out. Oh, it's definitely got diesel aroma. What happens if I press it 5 times now? So flashing means it's trying to connect. It's trying to light. Oop, heard it light off. Be curious, cat. Stick your face in front of that. That's it. Stick your paw in the hot pipe. Well, the light's on a steady state. Oh! Flashing. She's faulted. Shutting down. Maybe? Well, that don't look right. Oh, I guess we need to read the instructions a little bit better. Oh yeah, how's that smell? Sounds like water in the fuel. Blown out heat. It's not showing battery voltage anymore. There's obviously voltage happening because the fan wouldn't be running if it wasn't. All right, so she totally shut down. If that's the case, let's recycle the booster here. 10.7. All right, that ain't no good. Something's got to change. All right, so we solved this problem. Press and hold. Click. Fan comes on. Light is on steady. This time we'll try the power and light. Oh! It's the power and light button. Alright, let's figure this out now. 11 volts. Elevation of 566 meters. Fan is on speed 2. Ambient temperature. Let's see what happens. Press and hold, maybe? 4 hertz. Okay. 3.8. Ah, I see. Okay, so that's pump cycles. Alright, so the lowest it goes is 1.7 hertz. Hey, what do you know? Smoke cleared up. Alright, now we're getting somewhere. Now that I flooded the burner, we got a little bit of heat coming out of here. 11.2 volts. 3. Not sure the car's doing better than that, but. Well, what are you doing? Pump is still pumping, which means still pushing fuel in there. So I'm not sure whether that's fan speed or combustion chamber temperature, because I'm thinking that's combustion chamber temperature right there and not the fan speed itself, not the fuel pump down to 1.7. so it appears the fan blows enough to maintain the temperature of the heat exchanger. The amount of fuel going into the burner is what you're regulating. You can hear the pump cycling 1.7 times per second, or 17 times every 10 seconds. There's no 2 hertz. There's either 1.9 or 2.1. So as it puts more fuel in there and the temperature comes up on the heat exchanger, hands getting hot. Bump it up a little more. These are supposed to be for vehicles, campers, trucks. I don't think I'd want to listen to that all night. Of course, this does come with a muffler. So our muffler consists of this chamber with a spring coiled in the middle of it. Let's see how well it works. It knocks it down some, but not as annoying for the truck next to you. Alright, turn her up on high. Let's turn it up, go way high. Hertz. The ambient air is about 35 degrees. You can't hold your hand in front of it. That don't mean much, but you can't hold your hand in front of it. So now we need to test it out in a room of sorts. I have shut it off. I'm into cool down mode. So that was about 6 minutes or so. Well, it's working. Okay, I fired this up once in its new location. And prior to that, I was having to put the exhaust in, and I reached around here to feel where the exhaust was so I could put the pipe on it. And this is what happened. It's wet. So this had been off and sitting for probably a month, and the combustion chamber was loaded up with fuel. So when I started it up for the first time, the fuel pump never came on, but the glow plug did ignite the fuel in the combustion chamber, and then once it burned off and cleared out, well, then it shut off again all on its own. And I didn't have the opportunity to turn the temperature up. So in moving it about, I decided to pull off that exhaust, and sure enough, after letting it cool down, that is wet again. So, I'm in the greenhouse, and we want this to not get freezing in here. So this is where I'm going to do my test. The sun has just gone behind the ridge. Half an hour ago, it was 74 degrees in here. Now, 56. In all of the videos on YouTube, I have yet to see one where one of these has been installed as per its design, which was, like in the opening, it's supposed to be mounted in a vehicle. Like a sleeper in a truck, so you don't have to sit there and run the engine to stay warm all night. But I'm not going to do it either. So, hold the button. Click. You hear the click? And it comes on. There's supposed to be a light. There is the light. You don't hear the fuel pump clicking. I'm connected. It says 11.8 volts on that brand new battery. I'm kind of wondered about that. It shows that it's set to level 4 down here. So it's going to wait until it lights off inside. The fuel pump is not pumping. 10.7 volts. 10.6. We're just going to have to check that out.
Fuel pump started. The burner has lit.
Blue smoke?
Just a wee bit.
And that looks more like water vapor.
Oh, she's picking up steam. 11.1 volts. 2. So it must have turned off the glow plug. I gotta go get my voltmeter. See what's going on. There ain't much coming out of there. It's picking up though. Chose an ambient of 13 Celsius. Fan's on high. Setting is on high. I'm gonna get a voltmeter to check my battery. 12.3938. I thought maybe it was a bit inaccurate. Of course it may be accurate after you get the voltage loss through both the connections on this end and the other. But we're not gonna run out of battery overnight. All right, so we test fired it. I'm gonna shut it down. We'll shut it down by holding this down until it shuts off, or supposedly you can use the remote. You can't tell whether you're... Okay. Same thing, hold it. Now, here's another thing I don't like. It shuts down at full temperature. Drops the fan back to low. I would certainly rather see that the fan stayed on high until it cooled off, and then gradually, I mean, the fan, it gradually increases as the temperature raises, so I don't know why it shouldn't gradually decrease as the temperature drops. But I do not have an engineering degree. Now the fan picks back up again. Still shows that it's off. So if you're wondering about my meter, how it didn't used to look like this, that was mold that grew on there, sitting in the drawer of my toolbox. Lovely, isn't it? And a shout out to Eric. Pretty cool, should be shutting off. And there it is. Time to turn it on.
Current ambient, 26. 33. Power on. Hold till you hear it click. Click.
Fan starts. So that's the one thing I do like about this one over the others that have the readout. Of course, I've never used one of the others that has the readout. Fan speeds on two green lights. Setting is 5.5 hertz. That's 5.5 pulses per second. Pump is pumping. The fuel is ignited. We're talking about 19 degrees for the overnight low. We'll see what the little Vever can do for us. This is the 8,000 watt. Cold air. Little bit of heat. I'm getting some diesel aroma. Yep. Get a little diesel aroma out of here. That should not be. This is only the first test. See what happens later on. Definitely getting hot. Fan speed's all the way on high. I think I'm gonna knock it back to 5 hertz. Not trying to make it warm, just don't want it to freeze. Well, we'll see if a tank of fuel gets us through the night, what kind of temperature we got in the morning.
Let's see what happened. 26 degrees. We didn't expect the weatherman to be right, did we? 39, perhaps. Close to 40.
That wasn't on high. Pretty impressive. a crank drawn up to high. If I had the remote. That's why I don't like remotes. That's down. Up. Right up on high. Well, it sure made a difference in a hurry. Let's see what happens.
Well, let's go see what it looks like.
Yep. Still 25, 26.
Still cranking out the heat.
Well, pushed it up to 41. Now, that may not seem very impressive, but it is, because the storm came through here a couple months ago and took 20% of my roof off. So there's the big gaps up there, plus at the other end, things like that. It's not exactly sealed up in here.
Okay, a couple days later, gonna go for round two. Battery has not been charged since the last run, standing at 12.25.
Test number two. So they're calling for an overnight low of 27. We're already at 28, quarter after nine. It's a clear sky, which means it's probably going to get down to about 20. Okay, so we're starting out at 37 degrees. I already purged the fuel line of all the air. If you want to do that on this, hit this five times. That starts the fuel pump. You just listen to the tone of it, you'll know when it's purged the air. To turn it on, press and hold. Hear the click, release. So, remote shows we're on manual. 5.3 hertz. That's not high. Wait for this thing to get lit up here. So that's wide open throttle, if you will. Full fuel. 5.5 hertz. So we're gonna run it tonight. Giving it all she's got, Captain. And see how long that gallon of fuel lasts. If it lasts till the morning, what kind of temperature we have. You can hear the burner just lit off. It will continue to build. I'm gonna wait for this to get all the way to the top. Then I'll go in, because it's cold out here. And it's putting out some heat now, so I think it's time to go in. I'll see you in the morning. Which for you is in 3, 2. The next morning.
That's about as cold as it's gonna get. The unit is not running. It is 32 degrees. Well, this is still warm. So it didn't run out of fuel too terribly long ago.
So in conclusion, let's go through some pros and cons on the Vever 8 kilowatt diesel heater. Pros, the price. Now, if you weren't looking for diesel heaters, you wouldn't know what's out there. So the Webasto, or Webasto, or whatever you want to call it, we used to take those out of the buses when we were doing the RTS model retrofits, not retrofits, reman project back in the 1990s, take a 1981 GM RTS model bus, strip it down to a skeleton and put it back together to customer order. So a lot of those had Webasto diesel-fired heaters in them. Webasto is going to run you about $1,500. These are about anywhere from $100 to $150. The next pro is good fuel efficiency. As you saw in the first test, I had it on 5 pulses per second, which was just below the highest level, and it went over 12 hours, and it kept the temperature decent inside the greenhouse. And again, that greenhouse has a lot of leaks, so it actually did an excellent job of producing heat. So let's go over to the cons. I know there should be more pros than that, but what do you want the thing to do? Oh, here's another pro, and it seems kind of odd. I mentioned in the video that nobody that I have seen on YouTube has put this thing to use as it was designed for. So it was designed for an RV or automotive or trucking application where you don't want to leave your engine running to keep it warm inside the cab or inside your RV. It's not made to keep your greenhouse warm. It's not made to keep your house warm. It's not made to keep your shop warm. And that's what everybody's using it for. So I did come across a couple since I've been editing that were actually using them in RVs. So that's another plus. Because you don't really get an idea in a video like mine of how well it's going to work for the intended purpose. The cons. Safety. There is no way to turn it off, to turn off the fuel inside the unit. Once you fill that tank, there's no shutoff valve. It relies on the little pump to prevent the fuel. And you saw on this one, the fuel leaks into the combustion chamber and out into the exhaust when set for a long period of time with fuel in the tank. On the assembly, I made a short mention of it, although probably not enough. You see where the fuel line goes in to the... Well, I'll just show you. This is the image. Combustion air inlet, combustion exhaust, fuel line. This fuel line being that close to that exhaust is not a good thing. And especially with the melt point potentially of this plastic line. I think it might have been better had they created some sort of 90 that went on here that would or a heat shield that went in between the two. So if you get one of these units, I highly recommend putting a sheet of aluminum. Sheet aluminum will reflect 98% of all radiant heat. So it'll reflect that radiant heat back to here, and this will stay nice and cool, and you won't have a problem. I did actually make some video of having this apart and showing the stuff inside, but the video was running so long in my initial trying to get it started and stuff. What you saw in the beginning was my mistake of not properly reading the instructions. The other con, it draws power constantly. If you have this in a car, truck, van, or RV, if you don't operate this, it does not have a shutoff switch. When it's in the off position, you've got a substantial current draw, and your battery is going to be dead if you leave it set for 2 weeks. Pretty much the other con. And that can also be a safety thing, because this is not... I don't know if it's fused at all. I didn't look to see if it was fused. I didn't look in the manual to see if it was fused. But there should be a shutoff switch on this thing, and I highly recommend if you get one right where the contacts are, just put a little 12-volt shutoff switch in the back of that. And you can go to the small engine repair shop and you can get the, maybe they have them at Walmart. I don't know. Get the little fuel valve. I didn't check the size of the hoses. That you'll have to do yourself. You need to put an inline fuel shutoff valve on this thing. But overall, you know, for the money, it's a great little heater. I can't complain about it. I do think that for the average person who just wants to plug and play, it's unsafe. If you don't, if you're not mechanically inclined and you don't have the ability to take care of these things, if you want to get one, make sure you have somebody do something with putting a heat shield next to the fuel line, putting a fuel shutoff valve in it, and putting a disconnect switch for the 12 volt. So there you go. There's my rundown on the Vever heater. Hope you enjoyed it. And until the next video for Redneck Restorations, this old truck, I'm Jeff Bradshaw.